Come to California, they said. It would be great, they said.
Look at this rain. We're in San Diego with Hyundai to drive the new IONIQ 5.
Stay classy, San Diego. Not the case.
Whoa.
Feel the power. Wow. This thing is quick.
That's what's fun about electric cars. All right, what's under the floor of this IONIQ 5?
The entry-level IONIQ 5 standard range comes with a smaller 58 kilowatt-hour battery and rear-wheel drive only. It has 168 horsepower and 258 pound-feet of torque with 354 kilometers, 220 miles of EV range.
The rear-wheel drive long-range model with a 77.4 kilowatt-hour battery has 225 horsepower and 258 pound-feet of torque. The range on that is 488 kilometers or 303 miles.
The all-wheel drive long-range model has the most power. It has a 77.4 kilowatt-hour battery, 320 horsepower and 446 pound-feet of torque. It gets 414 kilometers, 256 miles of EV range.
Apparently, Andrea, it never rains in Southern California.
Never, but this is what I think. We brought the Vancouver rain with us. It is lashing down like Vancouver rain.
It's unbelievable the storm we're in right now. All right, let's take a breather and get into what do you get with this? What are the key standard features?
The standard range base trim comes with a 12.3-inch touchscreen, a 12.3-inch digital gauge cluster, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, LED interior and exterior lighting, 8-way power driver's seat, 4-way manual passenger seat, black cloth upholstery, heated front seats, 19-inch wheels, Hyundai SmartSense, including blind spot monitoring and rear cross-traffic alert and forward collision warning.
There's actually some buttons in here. We can adjust things. What are we going to put it in?
You got to put it in S for subscribe. And if you can hit that notification bell, you'll be notified when all of our reviews drop and then you can watch them.
And we do this a couple car review twice a week. The first one drops on Wednesday.
We put out another one on Saturday.
So make sure you subscribe, hit the bell, but also follow along on Instagram. It's motormouth_Andrea. For me, it's motormouth_Otto and the links are below. This video is brought to you by Canada Drives. Shop online for your next used vehicle and enjoy the convenience of two-year door delivery and the confidence of a 7-day love it or return it guarantee. Visit canadadrives.ca to learn more.
I really love how quiet the cabin is, just how smooth the ride is. It doesn't feel bumpy. It has a quick acceleration. Hyundai has done a really nice job with this.
So in comparison, we just 3 days ago drove the Model Y and we were surprised by how firm the suspension is and it's not adaptive. Now, the Mach-E, on the other hand, has a really kind of bucking rear suspension, very odd. This one, really, they nailed it. It's eating up the bumps.
I really like how you can control the regenerative braking in here with the paddle shifters at the steering wheel. It's got four settings, whereas the Model Y, you have no control over it at all.
So the drive of this, I would say, well, there's a lot of positives, and we're going to go through a lot of the things we like, and there's a lot to like with this car. But for me, I think it's the drive is the one I like the most. But then you get, Andrea, into the way this thing looks. It's very futuristic looking, but it's based on an old concept car, right?
Yeah, it's based on a 1974 Pony Coupe concept. And if you look at the picture, it's very sharp. It's kind of looks a little bit boxy as well. That's what this is kind of inspired by. I think it looks cool. It's futuristic. It's very modern. It has a bit of a maybe Audi vibe to it.
It looks upscale. That's a nice thing.
Yeah.
You're going to spend a lot of money and get an electric car. First of all, you're going to get credit because people are going to say, well, that's something different.
Yeah.
And it's got a lot of nice detail. It's very well designed on the outside. And we're going to get into it in questions, coffee, and cars. Like, how does it fit in the marketplace? Is it a car? Is it an SUV? So we'll touch on that in just a moment. So first off, it drives really well. It looks good. And then you get inside and it's bam.
Hyundai says this has got kind of a smart living theme, and I can see it. First off, this center console will move back and forth, so if I want to get out on the passenger side, I can do that. I think that that is brilliant. This seat on the top model, I can recline it all the way back. I tried it. I even have something for my legs.
It's got a little ottoman for your legs, and that's designed so when you're charging, you can have a nap if you're waiting to charge.
Yeah, it's a good idea. The amount this center console slides back and forth is 5.5 inches.
Sitting here, looking at those two screens in one framed unit really reminds me a lot of the MBUX system from Mercedes-Benz.
Yes, me too. First thing I thought of when I saw this, and that really has to do with the wonderful fit and finish in here. And also, you know, some of the touch points really have nature-inspired colors in here. They're kind of subdued with this light gray and taupe color. I really like what Hyundai has done to it.
And I love the ambient lighting in the armrest. There's one big armrest as a grab handle as well. So a lot of electric cars, they cheap out on the interior. They say it's to save weight and to cut, well, it's really to cut costs. But they didn't cheap out on this. And this is a learning point for other brands.
Yes.
It can be done in an electric car. I would say this moves to the top of the class for interior fit and finish.
Absolutely. And even this steering wheel, you know, it's got kind of a sporty, thick steering wheel with a flat bottom design. And in the middle, guess what? There's no Ioniq 5 logo or a written script. Just has these four little squares. Maybe that's the EV look.
Maybe that will develop over several cars.
One thing I love about this is just the openness in here. It feels so spacious, whether you're in the front row or you're in the second row. So in the US, there's three trims, SE, SEL, and Limited, and they all come with rear-wheel drive and all-wheel drive options. For us in Canada, we have two, Essential and Preferred. There's a Preferred Standard range, and there's a Preferred Long range, all-wheel drive, and then there's the Preferred range with the Ultimate package. That's what we've got. So if you go up one from the base model, that's where you're gonna get that heat pump and a heated steering wheel.
Which one turns into a boat? Oh my God, we need that today. You know, it's just terrible, I think, that Hyundai has missed the opportunity to provide all-wheel drive on a lower trim level.
Yeah.
Because what do we go on about in Canada? Oh, you need all-wheel drive. And that's, we've been marketed that, and people want that, especially in a crossover vehicle.
Yeah.
This is only available with all-wheel drive on this top model. And how much is that one, the base all-wheel drive?
Yeah, so it's almost $55,000 for the all-wheel drive model. But if you want all those extra features like the 20-inch wheels, the Bose premium sound system.
Basically the one you're seeing here in these
images. Yeah, you've got to spend an extra $5,000 and then you're coming in at just under $60,000 Canadian. Good news is that this qualifies for the federal rebate and some provincial rebates, and it also qualifies for the tax credit in the US of up to $7,500. Let's keep in mind the Tesla does not qualify for that because of its high price point.
Yeah, the Tesla competitor to this is the Model Y, is $76,000. So you could get this fully loaded one for roughly 60, as Andrea just mentioned.
Yeah.
That's a full $16,000 less, plus they're gonna throw money on the hood. That's not a bad deal.
It's not a bad deal. Good value here for an electric vehicle.
But I still say that this is not electrification for the masses.
No.
A $60,000 car is an expensive car for upper middle class families.
Yeah.
If you really wanna push the price down so many people can afford an all-wheel drive crossover vehicle, it's gotta be around 40 grand.
And one thing to point out with the Tesla is that it doesn't come with ventilated front seats. This does. Yes, the Tesla in the back has heated rear seats, so does this. So I do believe that there is value in this EV. It's just at $60,000, it still seems like a lot of money.
It is a lot of money, $60,000. We're going through a big puddle here. It's a lot of money. $60,000 is a lot of money for a car. Like, this is for people who have money. This is not a car that you can just, oh, we need a new, this is not a CRV replacement. Like, a RAV4 hybrid is $33,000.
Yes.
Or a Tucson hybrid is a lot less than this.
The ID4 for all-wheel drive starts at just under $50,000, but it's the same thing. You really need to get a package for $8,000 to get those extra features, and that's bringing you up close to $59,000 Canadian.
So
it really adds up.
So $59,000 for the ID4, $60,000 for this. It's a shootout. But this has a much, much nicer interior.
Oh, yes. And also the ID4 doesn't come with ventilated front seats or heated rear seats. So this is really the winner for value when you compare
it to its
direct competitors.
Yes, you compare it to other EVs, but there's not value in this when you can and go, as I mentioned, and get a RAV4 hybrid for $33,000.
Unless you want a pure EV, then this is one definitely to consider.
Now, like most electric vehicles, because it has a flat floor and the wheels are stretched to the corners, you get a lot of space in here. The back seat is really quite roomy. The nice thing is the seats move fore and aft, makes more flexible space for the cargo area. What are the numbers?
So this IONIQ 5 and the ID4 have really equal space in the second row, but it's the Mach-E that has more and the Tesla Model Y that has the most at 40.3 inches.
Now the rake of the cargo area limits the height of things you can put in this, but it's pretty useful.
The IONIQ 5 provides 27.2 cubic feet of cargo space behind the second row, less than the ID4, Model Y, and Mach-E. And to get even more cargo space, the second row seats can slide forward up to 5.3 inches, recline, and fold in a 60-40 split.
So this is a bit of a puzzle because I'm over here, and for questions, coffee, and cars, I gotta get over there. So the way this is gonna work, you won't see this. Andrea will walk over here, and I will get wet. Let's go there.
I actually said to him that we could both do it. It's so spacious
in
here.
No, it's not big enough.
That we can both shimmy.
That might be an adult video. All right, listen, we're gonna do that now. Okay, we decided to try it.
We're going with my route, because we could do it.
Because this is gonna be more fun.
Okay, here we go. This is how spacious this is.
I think you're overselling it. Okay, hang on a sec.
Put the mic. Zach is up. We did it!
Try that in a Buick.
I'm a little twisted, but here we go. How about that? We're ready. Questions, coffee, and cars.
Time now for questions, coffee, and cars.
Your questions from Instagram.
You are literally reviewing all three cars I'm considering after my lease is up in May. Of course, my questions are, how does it compare to the Model Y in terms of being a family car? It's much more interesting than the Tesla, but how closely does it come to overtaking it? My worry is that this is Hyundai's first crack at this and Tesla has a 10-year head start. Wow, good question.
Okay, I'm gonna go through three things I think this is better than the Tesla. First of all, the way it looks on the outside. Cool looking headlamps. The car actually has some decoration and design to it. The Teslas just look like blobs to me. So that's one positive. That follows onto the inside with a beautiful interior with materials that are head and shoulders above what you get in the Tesla. And we just drove that 3 days ago, so we're very familiar with it. And then the third one, and the most important to me, is the suspension calibration of this car is fantastic. It eats up bumps. It doesn't buck like the Mach-E. No. That's the best part of this, is the way it rolls down the road.
I agree with Zach on all of his points. One thing I think it is lacking in here is the technology compared to Tesla. As you said, Tesla's been doing it a long time. It is intuitive to use the Tesla screen. It's responsive. It's quick. When you use the voice commands, they are fast. Everything else about this touchscreen is easy to use.
It's like their other products.
For sure. And we really like it. We just didn't find it maybe as intuitive or as quick as the Tesla.
So we're driving around here. We don't know where we are. We're in Southern California, pouring rain, and we're going in and out of the map all the time. The nice thing is you just have a button there to push map, to go from the radio to the map and all that. So having some hotkeys there is very handy.
And then also you had another question about the glass roof. It's beautiful. The Tesla, one thing we noticed is the height. It's a little bit higher. So we find that maybe it's just a little bit more open, but this is a beautiful glass roof. With no actual buttons for heated and cooled seats, is there a quick menu available in the infotainment? The EV6 and the GV60 have physical buttons for these features, and I think Hyundai should add these as well.
I would agree with that.
Yeah. We like buttons, as you know, that's our thing. We like to have a heated button.
It just go boom and it's on. You have to go into the screen, but it's not like same thing. Once you've driven this for a while, you just go, okay, that's how I do it.
Yeah, it's very intuitive to use. Not a problem to go into the screen quickly and put the heated seats and ventilated front seats on. I thought that Hyundai would have given this a bit more range across all trims. Is the range better than the others in the EV segment? I'm not sure why Hyundai calls it an SUV when it comes across as a hatchback to me. Is it an SUV?
Well, it's a classic crossover. It crosses between a car and an SUV, and I think that really describes it best. Kind of got a lower ride height than you would get from a classic SUV, but it straddles both worlds.
It does, and some people will really like that. This offers about 6.3 inches of ground clearance, something like the Model Y has 6.7 inches, so that is a little bit of a difference. But I think it's a nice compromise between driving a car and driving an SUV.
They're kind of having their cake and eat it too, because people don't want to be seen to be driving a sedan or a hatchback, so they make it kind of, it's a nice looking vehicle. I'd be happy to have this in my driveway.
And when it comes to range, the Tesla Model Y offers the most, but this has more than the ID4. And when it comes to the Mach-E, the rear wheel drive model of this offers more range than the Mach-E, but it does fall short for the all wheel drive long range compared to the Mach-E. And I think this offers great range, in my opinion. I mean, they're all very similar.
Anything over 250 miles, anything over 400 kilometers, I think that's the sweet spot, and they're in it.
Yeah.
And now it's time for our hot topic. What's this one, Andrea?
Now, this is a review that I'm looking forward to. I think this and its Kia EV6 cousin are going to be the new benchmarks in electric cars. They are so far ahead of Toyota, Nissan, Honda, etc. Do you think that Hyundai Kia will become the leaders in electrification?
Well, currently the leaders in electrification are obviously Tesla. The last I read, 80% of registrations, it's like we're swimming. Oh my God, I can't believe that.
It's just like flying off the car.
80% of battery electric vehicle registrations in the United States, that's the data we have, are Teslas. So 20% goes to everybody else. That will change as more and more vehicles come on the marketplace.
Yeah.
So this isn't the leader. What it is a leader in is it has an 800 volt electrical system.
Yeah.
Same thing as Taycan. So this is a very advanced system for being able to take a charge in very quickly.
Hyundai is now the second largest company in Canada for EV sales. More than half of its portfolio has an electrified variant. We see that with the new Tucson Hybrid and PHEV coming out, as well as the Santa Fe.
They even have hydrogen car.
Yeah, I mean, they have really stepped forward. We're going to see it with Genesis as well. One thing that Tesla has that many other brands do not have is the charging infrastructure. I was speaking with Hyundai's president, Don Romano, last night, and we were talking about the charging infrastructure, and he had a really great point, is to put chargers at gas stations. Why can't we do it? There's usually parking stalls at gas stations, so why not put chargers in there? We see that with Petro-Canada right now.
Yeah, and that needs to be more widespread. Yeah. But that's their big advantage, is they have their charging network, they have great onboard technology, but we haven't really seen the Ultium?
Yeah.
The Ultium platform from General Motors and what they're going to do with that. So there's going to be a lot more competition, but they have a definite first mover advantage. It's amazing. 12 months goes by and you get a bunch of new EVs that are SUVs. So let's get into what else you can buy.
For your consideration, four vehicles for you to consider.
First up is the Volkswagen ID4 all-wheel drive with 386 kilometers, 249 miles of EV range. It has 302 horsepower and a starting price of just under $50,000.
Next is the Ford Mustang Mach-E with up to 475 kilometers of range and up to 346 horsepower. It has a starting price of $50,500.
One to watch out for is the Kia EV6 with both rear-wheel drive and all-wheel drive options. It has an EV range up to 480 kilometers, 300 miles, and up to 320 horsepower. There will also be a more powerful GT model. No pricing has been announced yet, but it will hit dealerships next year.
Here's our used car alternative from CanadaDrives.ca. We chose a 2016 Nissan Leaf SV with just under 70,000 kilometers for $20,990. Click on the tab or the link in the description below to find more vehicles in this category from CanadaDrives.ca.
So there are four electrified vehicles for you to consider.
There is a lot to cover. I call it a spreadsheet calculation of electric cars, the charging input, the batteries, all that kind of stuff. Let's get into it with our vital stats.
Let's start with pricing. The base rear-wheel drive standard range starts at under $45,000. The preferred rear-wheel drive long range is just under $52,000. The preferred all-wheel drive long range is just under $55,000. Add the ultimate package in Canada, and you're up to just under $60,000. The IONIQ 5 has a 10.9 kilowatt onboard charger, and the IONIQ 5 is compatible with a 400 volt and 800 volt charging station, With a level 2 outlet, it completes a full charge in 6 hours and 43 minutes. With a 350 kilowatt DC fast charger, it can be charged up to 80% in just 18 minutes, and a 5-minute charge will give you a range of up to 100 kilometers. The vehicle to load function, V2L, which is basically a charger on wheels, is available on all models for just over $300 Canadian. It can power small appliances, devices, and even charge other EVs or electric bicycles.
Here's some good news for IONIQ 5 customers in the US. You will receive unlimited 30-minute charging sessions for 2 years at Electrify America. The towing capacity is 2,000 pounds and the warranty is 5 years, 100,000 kilometers, or 60,000 miles. Lightning round, two things we like to see improved.
Well, I love how smooth and quiet the cabin is.
For me, it's the suspension.
I really like the design of the screen, but I find that it sits back a little bit too far for me.
And only one all-wheel drive trim in Canada at 55 is a starting price, is too expensive. They need to offer all-wheel drive on lower trims.
Innovative, futuristic, and some great technology in this IONIQ 5 Hyundai. You nailed it.
Waterproof too.
This video is brought to you by Canada Drives. Shop online for your next used vehicle and enjoy the convenience of to-your-door delivery and the confidence of a 7-day love-it-or-return-it guarantee. Visit CanadaDrives.ca to learn more.